Good morning, everyone. It's nice to see you all here for this beautiful Palm Sunday morning. The flowers appreciate it, and I'm sure we do too. If you are watching us online, please submit your prayer intentions. We at the staff every morning will remember them when we gather for daily prayer. Two other small notices for those of you in church who haven't noticed. I didn't notice till I looked really carefully on Friday. And you online cannot see this at all, is that a very ingenious, wonderful parishioner has built an aerosol screen for me on the organ. So I will be singing all through this Mass. If you'd like to join me, please do so with your hearts, but not on your lips. So I will be singing, and at the end of Mass, if my technology is good, you'll also hear a choir. I pre-recorded and mixed every member of the choir, including Willie here, to sing Jesus Remember Me, which you'll hear at the end of Mass, hopefully. At this time, we ask that you please put your phones on vibrate. Consider checking into Facebook to let your family and friends know where you are worshiping. We need your active participation at Mass. So if you don't have a worship aid, please download it. Simply go to www.seaseton.org. Go to the three lines in the upper left-hand corner and click the resources link. Then look for worship aids in the drop-down menu and click on the link. The first item that appears today is today's worship aid. Finally, let us sit in quiet for a moment, reflecting on the blessings of this past week and what lies before us in the days ahead, conscious of God's ever-present love. Please stand with me now. And our presider this morning, as you can see, is Monsignor Jeff Burrell, assisted by our deacon and homilist, Mr. Ray Moreau. Let's turn to our worship aids so that together we can proclaim the entrance antiphon. If you are at home, remember to have your bowl of water available and your palm branches. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Hosanna in the highest.
Dear brothers and sisters, the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of the Lord's paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. At this time, I invite everyone here in the church and joining us online to please raise your palms high for the blessing. Almighty and ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King with exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem with him, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Lord be
with you. And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus sent his disciples through near Jerusalem to Bethphage and Bethany in the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately on entering it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone should say to you, 'Why are you doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it, and will send it back here at once.' So they went off and found a colt tethered at a gate outside on the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They answered them, 'Just as Jesus had told them to,' and they permitted them to do it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. Those preceding him, as well as those following, kept crying out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaim Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace.
All glory, Lord, and honor to your Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children made sweet hosannas ring. You are the King of Israel and David's royal son. Now in the Lord's name coming, our King and Blessed One. All glory, Lord, and honor to you, Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children make sweet hosannas ring. The company of angels are praising you on high, and we with all creation in chorus make reply. All glory, Lord, and honor to you, Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children make sweet hosannas ring. The people of the Hebrews with palms before you went, our praise and prayers and anthems before you we present. All glory, Lord, and honor to you, Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children make sweet hosannas ring.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
My God, why have you abandoned me?
All who see me scoff at me. They mark me with parted lips. They wag their heads. He relied on the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him if he loves him.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
Indeed, many dogs surround me. A pack of evildoers closes upon me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
They divide my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. But you, O Lord, be not far from me. O my help, hasten to aid me.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
I will proclaim your name to my brethren, in the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, give glory to him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Our tradition teaches us that we stand for the gospel. However, if you cannot stand for a long period of time, you may be seated. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. When he was in Bethany, reclining at table in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of perfumed oil, costly, genuine spikenard. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it on his head. There were some who were indignant.
Why has there been this waste of perfume oil? It could have been sold for more than 300 days' wages and the money given to the poor.
They were infuriated with her. Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you make trouble for her? She has done a good thing for me. The poor you will always have with you, and whenever you wish, you can do good to them. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anticipated anointing my body for burial. Amen, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed to the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand him over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He sent two of his disciples and said to them,
"Go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there."
The disciples went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said,
Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.
They began to be distressed and to say to him one by one,
Surely it is not I.
He said to them,
One of the 12, the one who dips with me into the dish. For the Son of Man indeed goes, as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born.
While they were eating, he took the bread and said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them and said,
Take it, this is my body.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
All of you will have your faith shaken, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
Even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be.
Then Jesus said to him,
Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But he vehemently replied,
Even though I shall have to die with you, I will not deny you.
And they all spoke similarly. When they came to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
Sit here while I pray.
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch.
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass him by. He said,
Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will.
When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for an hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open, and he did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Then, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely.
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
Rabbi!
And he kissed him. At this, they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
Have you come out against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I was with you teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me, but that the scriptures may be fulfilled.
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man followed him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard and was seated with the guards, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, alleging,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple made with hands, and within 3 days I will build another not made with hands.'"
Even so, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned Jesus, saying,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But he was silent and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said to him,
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Then Jesus answered,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
At that, the high priest tore his garments and said,
"What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
They all condemned him as deserving to die. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him,
"Prophesy."
And the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was blowing the courtyard, one of the high priest's maids came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said,
"You too were with the Nazarene Jesus."
But he denied it, saying,
"I neither know nor understand what you're talking about."
So he went out into the outer court. Then the cock crowed. The maid saw him and began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
Once again, he denied it. A little later, the bystanders said to Peter once more,
"Surely you are one of them, for you too are Galilean."
He began to curse and swear,
"I do not know this man about whom you are talking."
And immediately a cock crowed a second time. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times. He broke down and wept. As soon as morning came, the chief priests with the elders and the scribes, that is, the whole Sanhedrin, held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
The chief priests accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned him,
"Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of?"
Jesus gave no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, on the occasion of the feast, he used to release them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was then in prison, along with the rebels who had committed murder in a rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release you, the king of the Jews?"
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted again,
"Crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted louder,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them. And after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
and kept striking his head with a reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage, and when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for them to see what each would take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him, they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Ay, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself by coming down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which is translated,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"Look, he's calling Elijah."
And one of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes down to take him down."
Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. The veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was the Son of God."
There were also women looking out from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of the younger James, and of Joses and Salome. These women had followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council, who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came and courageously went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Having brought a linen cloth, he took him down, wrapped him in the linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewn out of rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joses, watched where he was laid. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, since you've already endured the sacrifice of the longest gospel of the year, not only that, a second gospel, I'm going to try and keep this short. You know, if you look up the word sacrifice in the dictionary, you quickly come upon two definitions. The first one is the offering of something to a deity. And the second thing that you see has to do with relationships. In relationship, it's the giving up of something for the other. I'm sure all of you have made sacrifices in your life, you know, perhaps for your children, your spouse, your work, whatever it happens to be, your parents. Today, we get an example in the reading of this passion, of this gospel, of the ultimate sacrifice, an offering to the deity. Jesus offers himself up to the Father. Into your hands, Father, I commend my spirit. And he gives up for the other, and the other is us. And he suffers. You know, sacrifice often involves some sort of suffering. I mean, when you're giving something up, there's a certain amount of pain and suffering that goes along with this, and Jesus certainly made the ultimate sacrifice. And as we read this passion, it's packed with theology. I mean, you could do homilies on it every week. There are books written about it, college courses about it. But I would point out to you three things today about what God is saying to us in this gospel that I think are important for us to ponder, to think about. Three points that I think it's important for us to get. And the first one is this. Through our baptism, we are made members of the mystical body of Christ. We're part of his mystical body. And what that means is, when he offers himself up as a sacrifice to the Father, every time at Mass, we're offering ourselves up too, because we're part of his mystical body. The challenge, of course, the question is, what kind of offering is it? How perfect is our offering of our whole selves? What are we willing to suffer to make of ourselves a more perfect offering? Because in order to be a more perfect offering, we have to empty ourselves. We have to detach ourselves from the things of this world, and we have to overcome our sinfulness, and that involves a certain amount of pain and suffering. Let's face it, we all have an inclination to sin. We have our passions. We have our desires. We have things we don't like to do we should be, things we like to do that we shouldn't do. Being a better disciple, being more holy, being more perfect can be painful. But you know the old saying, no pain, no gain. So we're challenged, I think, in the remembrance of this passion, in the reading of it, and every time we're at Mass, where Jesus offers himself up to the Father, to think about what kind of offering we are, and we're challenged to go through whatever pain and suffering is necessary to die to ourselves and become more holy and become a better offering. A second point that I think is important not to overlook about the various accounts of the Passion is the idea about forgiveness. You know, in some of the gospel accounts, Jesus is on the cross, and after he's been brutalized in the most awful and painful way, and as he's executed, he says, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And in some of the accounts, the other revolutionaries crucified with him, sometimes the one known as the good thief, asks for forgiveness, and he forgives. And after all, the whole sacrifice that Jesus made of himself, all that he went through, was for the forgiveness of our sins. In a few moments, you're going to pray that perfect prayer that Jesus taught us, and hopefully you pray it regularly. And in that prayer, you're going to say, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." No fair asking God to forgive you if you're unwilling to forgive others. And you know, psychologists will tell you, forgiveness is one of the most difficult things that we do. When we're hurt, when we're angry, when we don't like somebody, our tendency is, you know, to want to hurt them back or to get them out of our lives. Yet, that's not what loving your neighbor is about, and that's not what forgiveness is all about. One of the sad things I've always thought about the cancel culture, about the anger in our country, about the abuse crisis in the church, about all those things, one thing I've noticed is we seem to have lost our sense of forgiveness. And yet, forgive we must. The disciples asked Jesus, "How many times do we need to forgive? 7 times? And he said, "No, 70 times 7 times. And you know, that scripture speak for every time, unconditionally, as if it never happened. And so I think today in the reading of this passion, God is speaking to us and challenging us to think about forgiveness, to think about thoughts and words and acts that we have that may not be forgiving. People we disagree with, people we don't like, people that have hurt us, people that have angered us, we must forgive. The last point that I think we should ponder that I think is very important is, you know, as you listen to all that they did to Jesus, putting that crown of thorns in his head, beating him down to his muscle until he was raw, driving nails through him, hanging him on the cross, spitting on him, all of those things that he did are a very potent reminder to us about the awfulness of sin. He died and suffered that for our sins. It's a teaching moment. Sin brings pain and suffering. And if you don't believe that, you're not looking at the news. Sin doesn't bring happiness, despite the fact that sometimes we think it does. Sin ultimately is awful. It brings pain. And the worst of sin can bring eternal death. And so I think it's something to remind ourselves about. The next time we're tempted to not do something God calls us to do, the next time we're tempted to do something we know we shouldn't be doing, to remember that it's awful and it brings pain and suffering, and to let the remembrance of this passion be an obstacle for us to prevent us from sinning. So, 3 things. Remember that when Jesus is offering himself up, you're offering yourself up. What kind of offering do you want to make to the Father? What are you willing to die to self for? Look at your life and identify the folks that are in need of your forgiveness and forgive them as Jesus is willing to do. And finally, remember, sin doesn't bring happiness. It doesn't bring joy. It brings suffering, and it can bring death. Let that serve as a warning the next time you're tempted to sin. So, last little point that I'll throw in is, this passion and death gives us great hope, because if we're able to make of ourselves a more perfect offering, if we're able to forgive well, If we're able to realize how terrible sin is, at the end comes resurrection. And so I offer you all a most blessed Easter.
With confidence, let us bring our needs and petitions to the Father.
Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer. For the church, that we may commend our lives to God each day and be renewed in the Spirit by God's faithful presence, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the leaders of government, that they recognize in Jesus, the King of the Jews, the model of leadership, and follow the example of Jesus in serving those entrusted to their care, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have experienced abandonment, betrayal, or rejection, that God's Spirit will comfort them, help them to hold fast to the truth, and bring them to new communities, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the victims of gun violence, especially those injured and killed in Boulder, Colorado, and Atlanta, Georgia, may they know the joy of God's unconditional love and eternal peace, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are suffering, that God will give courage to those recovering from storms, hope for those seeking employment, strength to caregivers, and protection to the vulnerable. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Ada Wagovich, whom we remember especially at this Mass. For all who are seriously ill or hospitalized, especially Mary Frantino, Mary Ann Doherty, Michelle Sparklin, Shell Schutz, and those suffering from the coronavirus, that God will ease their pain, help them to receive life-enhancing treatment, and restore them to their loved ones. For all who have recently died, especially Deacon Al Chesnavi, Gloria Dooley, Richard Dufresne, and for those who mourn the loss of loved ones from COVID-19, may they find comfort and peace in God's love for them and their beloved deceased. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the needs of our sister parishes in Haiti and Baltimore, and those we hold in the silence of our hearts, let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty and eternal God, as we recall and give you thanks for this Paschal mystery, we ask you to hear the prayers that we ask today and grant them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. O sacred head surrounded by crown of piercing thorn, O bleeding head so wounded, reviled and put to scorn, the power of death comes o'er you, the glow of life decays. Yet angel hosts adore you and tremble as they gaze. I see your strength and vigor all fading in the strife, and death with cruel rigor bereaving you of life. O agony and dying, or love to sinners Jesus, all grace applying, O turn your face to me.
Pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by the sacrifice made once for all, may we feel the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so, with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and martyrs, and all your saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people your Son has gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant us peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope of the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you stand under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
The Communion Antiphon. Father, if this chalice cannot pass without my drinking it, your will be done. Please be seated. A reminder that when we receive communion, we lay our hands flat in front of us. When Monsignor or when Deacon has gone to the next group of people, only then do we remove our mask, consume the host, and replace the mask covering nose and mouth. Thank you.
Here are today's announcements. Please sign up for Easter Masses through the parish website or Facebook page. This year, weather permitting, there will be an outdoor Mass at 11:30 on Sunday. You do not need to sign up ahead of time, but you will need to bring something to sit on. Poor box contributions this week will benefit Marion House. Easter offertory and flower envelopes have been mailed to all registered households. If you are able, please return them when you come to Mass, mail them to the office, or make an online donation through Give Central. Thank you for your continued generosity.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God is glorifying the Lord by your lives.
Thanks be to God. Please be seated. The ushers direct our safe exit from the church and do so via the center doors at the back. Please don't stand to leave until invited to do so by an usher. We make our way to the center doors at the back on the center aisle, the path to which you can see is marked off by blue social distancing lines. Please be careful not to get crowded with anybody. Every week is holy. This is especially Holy Week. Let's pray for each other that we can keep it that way. And as the music is played, try to maintain a spirit of silence and prayer.
Thank you. Thank you.